I remember the first time I saw you, my husband. I was all of 17 years of age. You were 18 years my senior and already a widower. I was not pleased with the widower prospect. It was but a burnt-out vessel offered to a fresh young creature, after a successful love had been identified with one soul life and removed by death. It is difficult to be content with anything less than the whole of a man's heart.
Thank you. you're a little young to think about marrying so soon. You haven't known him all that long.
But I love him.
We just don't feel that it's right for you to have a military husband. Your father just doesn't feel that's proper. I just don't know what to say to help you change your mind. You know your father and I are upset about this.
Dearest mother, I know will still return some feelings of affection for a child who has been so unfortunate as to form a connection without the sanction of her parents, but who will always feel the deepest affection for them, whatsoever may be their feelings towards her.
Sarah Knox Taylor, the daughter of the president. How she died in your arms while she sang the song Fairy Bells in her delirium. How you took me to her grave in Locust Grove Cemetery on our honeymoon and laid white flowers on her grave. How you never got over her tragic loss, and how you once faded dead away when we found one of her shoes in the attic by chance. We shall never be through grieving over poor little Knox. I begin to know the bitterness of being a politician's wife, the long absences, the illness from exposure, the misconceptions, the defamation of character, and everything which darkens the sunlight and contracts the happy sphere of home. Yet you are powerful, sir. Your mind dominates your body in so great a degree that you are able to endure what you please. I was only 19 when I curtsied to Mrs. Polk and looked around the White House for the very first time. Mrs. Polk was very decorous and civil in her manner to all. President Polk was innately single-minded, of simple tastes, and impunable honor, whose kind and deferential manner grew on me. During your early years in Congress, I was your working partner, writing, reading, and researching on your behalf. Your defense of Daniel Webster, though you are a conservative and he a New Englander, when he was accused of misusing a Secret Service fund when he was Secretary of the State under President Tyler. Our dinner with President Tyler in 1845, when he asked me playfully if he had ruined my dinner with his dull talk of politics, and how you answered him saying, "Oh no, my little wife is trying to be a statesman." Then you, a soldier and now a colonel, wounded in battle, working with Knox's father, the great General Zachary Taylor, who had not wanted you for a son-in-law and yet later could not wait to take you by the hand and have you near him.
Today I saw someone from my past, Representative Lincoln from Illinois. I hadn't seen him in since 1833, the close of the Black Hawk War, where we captured Chief Black Hawk. I had been sent to Dixon, Illinois to muster up some volunteers from the state. Lincoln was their captain, and I administered to him his first oath of allegiance. That was about 20 years ago. I'm convinced. Yes. It must have been.
Sam Houston, John C. Calhoun, dearest of all to me, as those statesmen go. Henry Clay, of whom I have reservations, and Andrew Johnson, who called you a member of the swaggering bastard scrub aristocracy. Oh, those we have known. Those on Olympia we have known.
I am sure I feel no hostility towards you senators from the North. I'm sure there's not one of you, whatever sharp discussions there may have been between us, to whom I cannot now say, in the presence of my God, I wish you well. And such, I'm sure, is the feeling of the people whom I represent towards those whom you represent. I therefore feel that I but express their desire when I say, I hope and they hope for peaceful relations with you, though we must part. In the course of my services here, associated at different times with great variety of senators, I see now around me some with whom I have served long. There have been points of collision, but whatever fence there has been to me, I leave here. I carry with me no hostile remembrance. Whatever offense I have given, which has not been redressed, or for which satisfaction has not been demanded, I have, senators, in this hour of parting, to offer you my apology for any pain which, in the heat of discussion, I have inflicted. I go hence, unencumbered, of the remembrance of any injury received. And having discharged the duty of making the only reparation in my power for any injury offered. Mr. President and Senators, having made the announcement which the occasion seemed to me to require, it only remains for me to bid you a final adieu.
Swaggering, scrub bastard aristocracy.
Swallow down my fears, my happy existence. Wait here.
Colonel Jefferson Davis.
Thank you, my good man. What have we here?
Urgent telegram, sir, from Montgomery, Alabama.
Oh. Oh, my.
Jefferson, what is it?
This requires a response. No! Spare me this responsibility! I'd love to head the army. Thank you, my good man.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Did you know that they have asked Robert E. Lee to lead the Union Army?
He won't do it.
He'll have to if Virginia doesn't secede.
Rally! Look! There is Jackson, standing like a stone wall. Let us determine to die here today, and we will conquer! They rally behind the Virginians!
I apologize, General Lee. President Davis has been detained.
I certainly hope he is experiencing good health today.
Oh, he is.
That's good. My lovely wife and Mary and my three daughters send their best wishes to you and the President.
Why, thank you.
I presume your children are all doing well?
Yes, they are.
They enjoying life as a child in spite of the circumstances we are now experiencing?
Why, of course, yes.
That's good. It's difficult to be a child in these times, you know.
I feel very badly for having had you come out all this way and not see the President.
It's no problem with the President being detained, I assure you. I should hope to visit with Custis if the chance presents itself before I must return to the Army. It's been good when I come here to visit you and the President on business that I get the opportunity to see my dear son. And I should hope on this occasion I would be able to visit with him as well.
Let us hope that you may, sir. The trip would not then have been a wasted effort.
As you well know, Mary's health is not all that we should wish it to be these days, and I have encouraged her on every possible occasion that she should seek better circumstances outside of the city. I have assured her that I believe the country air would do her and the girls a great deal of good.
Where have you suggested they go?
I've suggested that perhaps they could visit Bremo on the James. It would be a good respite from the city and the congestion and the problems here, and would probably find the company of friends, old friends at least, to be very gratifying to their spirit.
I imagine you and the Army are in a depressed state since the death of General Jackson. I cannot imagine the war without him.
I do miss General Jackson, so it still distresses me to have lost such an able officer and good friend.
Yes, I think that is the worst part of this war, the loss of friends and loved ones.
My friends! Fellow citizens, I thank you for the compliment that your presence conveys. It is an indication of regard, not for the person, but for the position he holds. Constant labor in the duties of office, borne down by care, with an anxiety which has left me scarcely a moment for repose. I have had but little opportunity for social intercourse amongst you. Called to the difficult and responsible station of Chief Executive of the government which you have instituted, I approach the discharge of those duties assigned to me with a humble mistrust in my ability, but with a sustaining confidence in the wisdom of those who are to aid and to guide me in the administration of public affairs, and an abiding faith in the virtue and patriotism of the people. Experience in public station of subordinate grade to this, which your kindness has conferred, has taught me that care and toil and disappointment are the price of official elevation. In me, you will see many errors to forgive, many deficiencies to tolerate, but you will not find in me either a want of zeal or lack of fidelity to the cause that is to me the highest in hope and of most enduring affection. Your generosity has bestowed upon me an undeserved distinction, one which I neither sought nor desired. Upon the continuance of that sentiment, and upon your wisdom and patriotism, I rely upon to direct me in those duties required at my hands. It is joyous in the midst of perilous times to look around upon a people united in heart, where one purpose of high resolve animates and actuates the whole, where the sacrifices to be made are not to be weighed in the balance against honor and right and liberty and equality. Obstacles may retard, they cannot long prevent a movement sanctified by its justice and sustained by a virtuous people. Reverently, let us invoke the God of our fathers to guide and direct us in our efforts to perpetuate those principles which, by His blessing, ever gratefully acknowledged, we may hopefully look forward to success, to peace, and to prosperity. My hopes are reverently fixed on Him whose favor is ever vouchsafed to the cause which is just. With humble gratitude and adoration, acknowledging the providence which has so visibly protected the Confederacy, to Thee, O God, I trustfully commit myself and prayerfully invoke Thy blessing on my country and her cause. The cause in which we are engaged is the cause of the advocacy of those rights to which we were born. The cause for which our fathers of the Revolution bled. The richest inheritance ever to fall to man, in which is our sacred duty to pass untarnished to our children. My first object of necessity is to prove by historical authority that each of the states, as sovereign parties to the compact of union, had the reserved power to secede from it whenever it is found not to answer to the ends for which it was established. This being done, then it follows that the war is on the part of the United States government one of aggression and usurpation, and that on the part of the South of the defense of an inherent and unalienable right. The issue then being, will you renounce the exercise of those rights to which you were born and which were transmitted to you by your fathers? I feel that when addressing Virginians, that your answer will be that your interests, even life itself, shall be willingly laid down on the altar of your country. And I feel that if the Old Dominion were destined for such a fate, I would wish to sleep in her soil. I invoke you not to hesitate a moment, but to rush forward and place your services at the disposal of the state. Let us all lock shields and stand together. And in the end, you will enjoy an amount of prosperity you could not obtain connected at the hand of the Yankee Nation of extortioners. Every crime which could characterize the course of demons has marked the course of the invader, and you have been involved in a war waged for the gratification of the lust of power and of aggrandizement. For your subjugation, with a malignant ferocity and utter contempt of the usages of civilization entirely unequaled in history. Verily, these are the times that try men's souls. The summer soldier and the sunshine patriot will, in this crisis, shrink from the service of their country. But he that stands it now deserves all the love and thanks of man and woman. Tyranny, like hell, is not easily conquered. Yet we have this consolation with us. At the heart of the conflict, the more glorious the triumph. You have fought mighty battles, and your deeds of valor will live amongst the richest spoils of time's ample page. And we must remember that the impartial and enlightened verdict of mankind will vindicate the rectitude of our course. And he who knows the hearts of men will judge of the sincerity with which we labor to preserve the government of our fathers in its spirit. Thank you, and good day.
Thank you. Something's got to happen. Well, you know, the South is running out of manpower.
Sure is.
We keep having these victories, as I call them, but they're hollow victories. They're pyrrhic. Because we win the day, we carry the field, but then when we leave the field, we've lost 10, 20, 30, 40,000 in casualties that we can't make up. Federals, they've got plenty of manpower sources that they can draw on, but we can't, and we keep losing people at this kind of rate. So they're going to get somebody in there up north that realizes this just a war of attrition, and they're going to pour it on us one of these days and just grind us down to nothing, knowing that we can't replace these people. And that might be the death knell for the Confederacy, I'm afraid, if we don't hurry up and get something done here pretty quick.
Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly. While the nearer waters roll, while the tempest still is high, hide me, O my Savior, hide, till storms of life are past. Safe into that haven guide, there will be my soul at last.
I think it is absolutely necessary that we should abandon our position tonight. I have given all the necessary orders on the subject to the troops, and the operation, though difficult, I hope will be performed successfully. I have directed General Stevens to send an officer to Your Excellency to explain the routes to you by which the troops will be moved to Amelia Courthouse and furnish you with a guide and any assistance that you may require for yourself. R. E. Lee.
Goodbye, Moss Davis.
I recall in 1832 at Fort Winnebago when Chief Blackhawk upended a man from his saddle and made good his escape. He grabbed his stirrup and threw him out of his saddle. If I am accosted in the same manner, I will try my old friend's trick.
Excuse me, sir. The president has need of this wagon. We borrow it.
Anything the president wants, he can have it.
Thank you, sir. We knew we could count upon you.
Anything for the South.
Yes, sir. He's sadly on the run at this moment.
Yeah. Tell me which way and I'll catch up with you.
Thank you, sir. We knew we could count on you.
Before we were serving in Mexico, you came over from General Scott's headquarters to visit Garland's brigade, to which I then belong. I remember your appearance, and I'm sure I would have recognized you anywhere.
Yes, I know we met on that occasion, and I've often thought of it and tried to recollect how you looked, but have never been able to recall a single feature.
That was some army we had back in Mexico, wasn't it, General?
Those were very different times indeed. I suppose, General Grant, the object of our present meeting is fully understood. I asked to see you to ascertain upon what terms you would receive the surrender of my army.
The terms I propose are those as stated substantially in my letter of yesterday. That is, the officers and men to be paroled and disqualified from taking up arms again until properly exchanged. The arms, ammunition, and supplies will be given up as captured property.
Those are about the conditions I expected would be proposed.
Yes, I think our correspondence of the last few days has indicated pretty clearly the action to be taken at our meeting today. And I hope that it leads to a general suspension of hostilities and may be the means to prevent any further loss of life.
I suppose, General Grant, we have both carefully considered the proper steps to be taken and would suggest you commit to writing the terms which you have proposed.
I'll write them out. General R. E. Lee, commanding CSA Army. General, in accordance with the substance of my letter to you of the 8th instant, I propose to receive the surrender of the Army of Northern Virginia on the following terms. To wit, rolls of all the officers and men to be made in duplicate. One copy to be given to an officer to be designated by me. The other to be retained by such officer or officers as you may designate. The officers to give their individual paroles not to take up arms against the government of the United States until properly exchanged. And each company or regimental commander to sign a like parole for the men of his command. The arms, artillery, and public property are to be parked and stacked and turned over to the officers appointed by me to receive them. This will not embrace the sidearms of the officers, nor their private horse or baggage. This done, officers and men will be allowed to return to their homes, not to be disturbed by the United States authority, so long as they observe their paroles and the laws in force where they may reside. Very respectfully, U.S. Grant, Lieutenant General.
After the words "until properly," the word "exchange" seems to be omitted. You doubtless intended to use the word.
Yes, I thought I'd put in the word "exchanged."
I presumed it had been omitted inadvertently. And with your permission, I will mark where it should be inserted.
Certainly. Unless you have some suggestions as to the form in which I've stated the terms, I will have a copy of the letter written in ink and sign it.
There is one thing I would like to mention. Cavalrymen and artillerists own their own horses in our Army. Its organization in this respect is different from that of the United States. I would like to understand that these men will be allowed to retain their horses.
No, you'll see the terms as written do not allow it. Only the officers may keep their private property.
No, I see the terms do not allow it. That is clear.
I won't change the terms as they're now written. However, I will instruct the officers that I appoint to take the paroles to allow any man who claims to own a horse or mule to take that animal with them to work their little farms.
This will have the best possible effect upon the men. It will be very gratifying and do much towards conciliating our people. I have 1,000 or more of your men as prisoners, General Grant. Some of them officers whom we have required to march along with us for several days. I would like to send them into your lines as soon as it can be arranged, for I have no provisions for them. I indeed have nothing for my own men. They have been living for the past few days principally upon parched corn.
I'm sorry, but we have no forage for the animals. In fact, we've had to rely on the countryside for our own supply of forage. I would like to have our men sent within our lines as soon as possible, and I will take steps at once to supply your army with rations. Of about how many men does your present command consist of?
Indeed, I cannot say. My losses in killed and wounded have been exceedingly heavy. And besides, there have been many stragglers and some deserters. My own public reports and letters, and indeed my private letters, had to be destroyed on the march to prevent them from falling into the hands of your people. Many companies are entirely without officers, and I have not seen any returns for several days, so I have no means to ascertain our present strength.
Suppose I send over 25,000 rations. Do you think that will be sufficient?
I think that will be ample, and it will be a great relief, I assure you. I would like to know that General Meade will be notified of the surrender, so that firing might not break out.
To save time, I'll send two messengers through your lines to General Meade's headquarters.
Very well.
God bless you, General.
General Grant.
Thank you. Tom, let's capture those things. Let's find out who they are. Let's go, boys. Let's go get the towel.
Mr. President, I fear the federal cavalry is within 20 miles.
Very good, gentlemen. Thank you. We must be proceeding along our journey.
I fear it's federal cavalry.
Surrender! How do you feel now, Jeffy? Do you have any weapons?
If I had, you wouldn't be alive to ask that question.
Yeah. Have you checked him?
Yes, sir. We checked him. He's not armed.
I wouldn't trust him.
Not so important now, are you, Mr. President?
So move him out. Let's take him to the provost.
Move.
Can you believe they caught Jefferson Davis?
I hope they hang Jefferson Davis from a sour apple tree. He caused a lot of good men to get killed. Well, a few ain't so good, too. A few of us that are left, we just as soon he ain't never started none of this kind of stuff.
I'll support President Davis. Secession never was treason. It was perfectly legal to fire on Fort Sumter, sir. The federal government can no more prove treason than they can disprove the Constitution, sir.
Certainly I'll defend Jefferson Davis. Secession is not treason. He's a patriotic gentleman. The Constitution was made for a union of states, not an empire.
Sir, I appreciate your passion, and I think you're a little bitter because of the war, and I understand that. We all have our hurts and feelings, but a union can't be held together by force. That's an empire. That's what, you know, England would do. You know, that's why we rebelled against them. You know, we seceded against them. Sure. Because our rights weren't recognized. That's the same thing that happened, that the South also did. You may agree or not agree with them, but that's what happened, and I really don't think, you know, you should try this man.
Sir, closure will only come for the people of the North, and the wounds of this country will only be healed once Jefferson Davis is tried for treason and dealt with by the U.S. government.
It'll cause another war.
No, it will not cause another war.
Let the government try this man, they will try him. I'll take the case. I'll gladly take this case
and win. The people of the North, sir, demand restitution.
Sir,
what about you tell, we need restitution.
Exactly. You tell us women that were in the home front. You tell us when our men
fought for constitutional rights were killed by the hundreds when there were just years
Madam,
of women wearing black.
They shouldn't have followed
I'm so
a rebellious
sorry. You
government.
Are quite wrong.
They
we
should have not followed a
You
false
are going
leader.
To make us even madder by your dictatorship that ruled here. No.
I really don't care. The man committed treason, and the man will be tried
for treason.
Well, what
you're saying is treasonous yes. to me.
And I will win.
I'm very grateful you have decided to see me, sir.
Not at all, ma'am. Would you care for some tea, perhaps?
No, sir, I have not come for tea. I have come to secure my husband's release from that dreadful place.
Ma'am, we must wait. Our hope is to mollify the public toward him.
There would be no need to mollify the public but for your proclamation that my husband was an accessory to the assassination of President Lincoln. I am sure that whatever others believed, you did not credit it, sir.
Indeed not, ma'am. Indeed not. But at present, I am in the hands of wildly excited people. I must take such measures as would show that I'm at least willing to sift the facts.
You owe my husband a retraction as public as your mistake, then. There was never even the slightest intercourse between John Wilkes Booth and my husband. Can the same be said for Colonel Dahlgren and Abraham Lincoln in the matter of the attempt upon my husband during his presidency?
I am laboring under the enmity of many in both houses of Congress. If they could find anything upon which to hinge an impeachment, they would degrade me accordingly. If I could offer a retraction, I would. But I cannot. Has your husband thought of requesting a pardon?
He has not. That would be tantamount to a confession for him. The South is guilty of nothing. From what would he ask pardon?
I have never believed that your husband was involved in Lincoln's murder. I was compelled by Stanton and Holt to issue that proclamation. They assured me that they had conclusive evidence of complicity. You must understand, my own position was so insecure and popular excitement so great at the time that I fell into their wishes.
Very well, then. Let us see what we can do. I have been counseled not to ask for a parole. I merely seek, therefore, to establish my family group at the Fortress Monroe. I urge the range of the fort for my husband that he may be allowed to move about freely.
Go on. I'm listening.
I also propose the removal of General Miles. I argue most emphatically that he does not respect the person or the feelings of Jefferson Davis.
I have a letter from Dr. Cooper that I may use in this regard. He does say that your husband is growing weaker by the day, though he does everything he can to sustain him. If I may quote him, he says he must have mental and bodily rest and exercise at will. And he says also that he must have the freedom of the fort with permission to remain with his family.
I think that is very well spoken, sir.
You know, General Miles has intimated to me that you've had quite an effect on him since your arrival at the fort. I can quote him directly, I think. Let me see. Ah. Since Mrs. Davis's appearance at this place, there has been a determined effort that, as he could not be a hero, to make a martyr of him.
Tell me, if you can, President Johnson, the exact and definite difference between the two. Good day, President Johnson.
My good young soldier, you must be tired. Please desist. Therefore, a mouse I am domesticating.
President Davis, my name is Captain Jerome Titlow, Company K, 3rd Pennsylvania Artillery.
My pleasure to make your acquaintance, sir.
I have been retained to see to any needs that you might have while you are here. Casemate 2, Fortress Monroe.
I understand. My days drag heavily on. To what? I have no means to direct or to foresee. A heavy burden of oppression rests upon me, and the prospect of the future looks gloomy in the extreme.
I have been told that Mrs. Davis's efforts will have President Johnson reassign this fort's commander, General Miles, with General Henry Burton. Should go easier on you. President Johnson has strongly hinted yet again that he would grant a pardon if you applied.
Confident of the justice of our cause and the rectitude of my own conduct, I decline. I wish for a trial in an open court.
to prove that secession was not treason. I cannot ask for pardon for what I do not consider a crime. Judge Underwood's formal charge states, Davis, most wickedly, maliciously, and traitorously, waged war against the United States. Not having the fear of God before his eyes, and being seduced by the instigation of the devil. It is politics, not law, that governs my case. The deepening conflict between the Republican liberals and Congress and the President hold me hostage. I shall not be surprised if President Johnson is charged with treason before I am. I am supported by the conscious rectitude of my course and humbly acknowledging my many and grievous sins against God can confidently look to his righteousness for vindication in the matter whereof I am accused by man. Of the final result of any proceeding against me, be hopeful. My conduct has been too public, too consistent to be perverted after slanderers are confronted by the truth. Often it has occurred in the world's history that fidelity has been treated as a crime and true faith punished as treason. You should be free, or all other Confederates arrested.
What do you think is going to happen if Jefferson Davis is tried?
I don't think there's enough evidence to convict him, soldier. I think that at this point in the war, it's time to heal. Besides, the South did have the right to secede. It did have the right to form a new presidency. Secession is only illegal in the eyes of the sitting Liberal Party. The question now is, how much of the original Constitution are we going to retain? So I don't think there's enough evidence to convict him, and I don't think there will be a trial. I think he will be released. As a matter of fact, how is he being treated at Fortress Monroe?
Well, we have removed his shackles today, and we're giving him more freedom to go to the necessary. Unfortunately, we was escorting him there, but now he's got more freedom now.
Well, it's good that you're treating him well. We don't want any mistreatment of a prisoner, even, of course, of someone of Jefferson Davis's stature. So please treat him well, and maybe the Union and the whole country can heal.
We'll be together always. We'll be together always. Mm-hmm.
One day, all this vituperative fabrication will only be remembered as a matter of shame.
Our chains are forged. Their clanking may be heard upon the plains of Boston. The war is inevitable, and let it come. I repeat it, sir, let it come. It is in vain, sir, to argue the matter, gentlemen. They cry, peace, peace, but there is no peace. The war is actually begun. The next gale that sweeps from the north will bring to our ears the clash of resounding arms. Our brethren are already in the field. Why stand we here idle? What is it the gentlemen wish? What would they have? Is life so dear? Or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? Forbid it, Almighty God! I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty! Or give me death!
As you know, I am having severe dental trouble. My eyes are inflamed and I am quite ill. I am torn between the urgent need to have all but 3 teeth removed and anxiety to be my most effective self during these crucial negotiations on your behalf. I feel I cannot see people till my plate is finished, but I can live just as well without them, however unlovely I shall appear. I do hate it, however.
If I alone could bear all the sufferings of the country and relieve it from further calamity, I trust our Heavenly Father would give me a strength to be a willing sacrifice. It is true that my strength has greatly failed me, and the loss of sleep has created a morbid excitability, but an unseen hand has sustained me, and a peace which the world could not give and has not been able to destroy will, I trust, uphold me to meet with resignation whatever may befall me. Have confidence in my ability to bear much and to bear long. Above all, be not disturbed by the unwarranted statements of those news gatherers who would earn their living by coining the tears of the afflicted. My heart is sustained by the conviction that we shall meet again in this world, that even before human judgment, my innocence of wrong to my fellow man will prevail, though many seek my destruction. You will realize the necessity of extreme caution in regard to our correspondence. The quidnuncs, if they learn you have received a letter from me, will no doubt seek to extract something for their pursuit, and your experience has taught you how little material serves to spin their web. My dear wife, equally the center of my love and confidence, remember how good the Lord has always been to me, how often he has wonderfully preserved me, and put thy trust in him. Farewell. May he who tempers the wind to the shorn lamb, whose most glorious attribute is mercy, guide and protect and provide for my distressed family, and give to them and to me that grace that shall lead us all to the final rest in the mansions where there is peace that passeth all understanding. Once more, farewell, your husband, Jefferson Davis. Good morning, Verena. How pleasant it is to see you, my darling.
Gridiron upon which we have been fried.
Let's see. Dear Captain Titlow,
I have learned from my husband of your kind treatment afforded him regarding the removal of the shackles during his time at Fortress Monroe. His ankles had been deeply abraded, and we had never expected him to be subjected to such indignity. Like the Good Samaritan, you gave him relief and proved that he had not passed the limit of humanity. Without your benevolence, his captivity would soon have ended in death. Bitter tears have been shed by the gentle, and stern reproaches have been made by the magnanimous, on account of the needless torture to which my husband was subjected. The lamp burning in his cell at night would seem a torment devised by someone who had intimate knowledge of his habits, his custom having been never to sleep except in total darkness. Mold grew upon his shoes, showing the dampness of the place, and no animal life could prosper in an atmosphere that had generated these hypomycetous fungi. When I asked General Miles if I could have lodgings within the fort, Miles suggested I stay with the local prostitutes. You, on the other hand, arranged for me to stay in a casemate near the officers' wives. I am ever grateful for your applications upon my behalf, sir. Of all that passed for decency towards my husband during those dark days of his captivity, I am sure we have you, sir, to thank for their invention and instigation. And please, sir, know that I am, as I shall ever be, respectfully and truly yours, Verena Jefferson Davis.
I'm ready.
My first object in this work was to prove, by historical authority, that each of the states, as sovereign parties to the Compact of Union, had the reserved power to secede from it, whenever it should be found not to answer to the ends for which it was established. Where now are the inalienable rights of man, and the sovereignty of the people with their safeguards? The Constitution, with limited powers, the reserved rights to the states, and the supremacy of law, equally over both rulers and the ruled? All are gone. The United States government controls as the sovereign, and the sovereignty of the people is extinct. Will it always be thus? Is the inherent sovereignty of the people destroyed by shot and shell? Will it stand? Have the eternal principles of the Declaration of Independence been hid from our sight forever? Or will they again come forth, redeemed, disenthralled, regenerated, and rally the reunited people to the shout in thundered tones for sovereignty of the people and the inalienable rights of man? The day is coming in which mankind beholds its government in utter violation of those rights which belongs to its own citizens. In every state, North and South, the bills of rights and the written constitutions have all lost their sacred authority, and not a man nor a state dare single-handedly speak against a government which, feeling power, has forgotten what is right. It has put its hand upon the ballot box
and actually said that it is not safe to trust the people to vote, after the example of the Roman emperors. When the cause was lost, what cause was it? Not that of the South only, but the cause of the constitutional government, of the supremacy of law, and the natural rights of man. Whenever it pleases, it can cast them aside. Wherever it wills, it can destroy them. Inalienable rights are unknown to this war-begotten theory of the Constitution. In asserting to the right of secession, it has not been my wish to incite to its exercise. I recognize the fact that the war showed it to be impracticable, but this did not prove it to be wrong. I think that I am done.
May all your paths be pleasant, charged with the best of fruit, those of helping others.
The past has gone away from me, I seem to be forgetting things that I once knew. Looking through the photo albums, I can't put names to faces. I can't live with that. I don't know what to do. Cause I can't remember you. No, I can't remember you. Memories are fading my mind, the ones that I thought that I would never lose. But now I open my old shoebox. Why was that ticket stub so special? This is a bearer of bad news. Cause I can't remember you. No, 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 I can't remember you.
If the folly and the fanaticism and the pride and the hate and the corruption of the day are to destroy the peace and the prosperity of the Union, let the sections part like the patriarchs of old, and let the peace and the goodwill subsist to their descendants. Let the flag of our union be folded up entire, and the 13 stripes which recorded the original size of our family be untorn by the ravages of this unholy civil war.
I should wish, Miss Davis, that all your privations be replaced with a gracious providence. A nation that must be held together at the point of a sword holds no charm for me. Perhaps, after this is all behind us, we shall look on to brighter and happier times, indeed.
Good evening, ma'am. May I help you?
Oh, what a noble-looking lady.
Why, thank you, ma'am. And you are?
Oh, my apologies, please. It's just that I've been waiting so long to meet you.
I'm truly flattered, miss.
It was Mrs. many years ago. You would know me by my married name, my husband's name, just as I know you by yours, Mrs. Davis. I am the former Julia Dent. You would know me as Mrs. Ulysses S. Grant. Oh. I've just been waiting to meet you. I thought we had some things we could talk about and discuss. If you would like to talk about some things that concerned both of us at one time.
Please, Mrs. Grant, do come in. It's just that I'm so surprised.
Oh, I should have announced my intentions before coming to meet with you, but I'm just so thankful that you've agreed to meet with me unannounced.
Not at all. Not at all.
From 1869 to 1884 was the most wonderful period of my life. My husband and I traveled around the world, and we had wonderful gifts and beautiful hospitality from people. And then in 1884, we got into a bad business venture, and we lost all we had. If it weren't for Ulysses writing his memoirs, we would have been destitute. Well, that's when I started to think of you and your situation, because your husband was writing The Rise and Fall of the Confederate Government. Strange, the irony. My husband couldn't speak, but he could write. And your husband couldn't write, but he could speak.
Yes, I remember. Finished about 4 one morning. I remember it well.
I had asked Ulysses to let me be a peace emissary to the Confederate States in 1864, but he wouldn't allow me. I always thought we could have had peace arranged long before that business at Appomattox. I guess it turned out after all, anyway. But we could have had peace arranged, rather the way like you received me here today.
Well, I'm grateful for your statesmanship. Jefferson said more than once that I was trying to be a statesman myself.
This is 1893. Do you think the world should know that I came here to meet with you today? Do you think they're ready for that?
Jefferson always said the South didn't want its own country. It wanted the country it had up north. Let's just see what they say.
Feel the touch. fears can be relieved, but I'm still searching for my way. For my purpose, and I live out each day. So I lay my life down so I can find out who I'm meant to be.